I do believe that we're in a time that God is raising up a particular type of a person. And the person that I like to call this person is the replacement.
Yeah.
I like to feel that the replacements have been ordered and that there is a new regime. There's a new wave that God is wanting to enter into the earth and even in the churches. So we're seeing a lot of new things, things which we haven't seen before. And I'll just give this prophetic disclaimer that just because you've never heard it before doesn't mean
yes.
it's the truth.
And yes.
doesn't mean it isn't God.
Yes.
That everything God does is not confirmation. Some things is revelation.
Yeah.
And so God is he's bringing a whole new order to some things. God is using people like our bishop to do things that has
Amen.
Never been
Amen.
Seen
Amen.
Before. And so people like her are taking positions that have been there for a long time. And he's moving certain people out of place so that way the replacements can fall into place.
Yeah, yes. Amen. Amen. Amen.
And so Bishop was talking a little bit about these mantles, and she was saying that mantles actually never leave the earth because there's no need for the mantles in the heavens. The earth is the one that needs the mantles. And so when God created mantles here on the earth, he created them so that way they can fulfill a particular thing in the earth realm. And so even if a person leaves the earth, the mantle stays. Amen. And so let's go to 1 Kings chapter 19. And we're going to start at about verse 13. When you have it, say amen. All right. It says... And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle or his cloak. And he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, for the God of hosts, and for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant and thrown down your altars. They have killed your prophets with the sword, and I, even only I, am left. And they seek to take my life away." And the Lord said to him, Go and return your way unto the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be the king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be the king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Amoriah, you shall anoint to be the prophet in your place. Let's notice that said that he shall anoint Elisha to be the prophet in his place.
Yes.
And it says, verse 17, "And the one who escaped from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death, and the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall put to death." And the word of the Lord is blessed. Let's stop there. I'll go there later. Okay, so as Bishop said, that the first time we actually hear something, a very normal demonstration of mantles, we see it, and this is usually the example we see mantles being exchanged and being transferred from one person to another. Although we know this isn't the first time, I mean, we've seen Moses and Joshua, we've seen a few other times mantles being changed, but this is the most noted one that's of mantles being changed. Here, Elijah had experienced a lot of hardship in terms of ministry. Jezebel was still after him, Ahab was angry with him. And all the prophets who were prophets of God, they had turned it over to Baal, and he was in a place where he actually felt that he was the only prophet left. And he was like, "God, there's nobody left in the world. There's no more prophets but me." And so he was actually bargaining with God and actually asking God if God could take his life to kill him. He actually wanted to die. He felt that it would have been better if he had been dead than he was alive. And so during this time, he was hiding out in the cave, and God was like, "Hey, what are you doing here? There's still things that need to be done." And so God said, "Okay, listen, since you want out of this, there's only going to be one way you can get out of it. I still need you to anoint the next king. And I'm going to cause you to find a young man named Elisha. When you find Elisha, you're going to anoint him, and he is going to take your place. So, bless you. The Bible says that Elijah, the next day, he started to fulfill these things that God told him to do. And so while he was looking for Elisha, he seen Elisha, and Elisha was actually working. He was working, the Bible says, 12 oxen. He was plowing a field. And when the prophet Elijah seen him, he threw his mantle on him and kept on going. One thing I think is interesting is that when God, thank you, Holy Spirit, when your mantle first shows up in your life, the mantle does not show up with this crazy big announcement. And usually when the mantle of God first shows up in your life, you're usually busy doing something else.
Right.
I thought it was interesting that Elisha was already working.
Yes.
And so could you imagine what Elisha felt, that in his mind, every day he went to work working on this big, large field. It had to be large. If 12 oxen was able to plow it at one time, then it had to be a lot of land. But he was working this. Could you imagine what he was thinking in his mind? Because he never knew there was an alternative assignment for his life. But yet he had to give himself wholly to what was presented to him.
Yeah.
So could you imagine you are at work, and all of a sudden while you're at work, somebody shows up to you and say, hey, listen, I have a new job offer for you at a whole other company, and I need you to let go of this job right now and just leave. It'll be seem kind of odd. You'll say, well, let me give my 2-week notice. What kind of job is it? What are you talking about? What am I supposed to do? All these things. But the Bible says that when he seen him, he just threw it on him, and Elijah started to follow him, but then he said, wait, before I follow you, let me end out these few things. Let me kiss my mother and my father goodbye, and then I'm going to follow after you. Two things I thought was interesting. One is, he had never met Elisha prior to this moment. A lot of times, the person who actually has your mantle, you actually might not know in your present life. When they show up, they just kind of appear in your life. They just literally pop up in your life. And when you meet them, something in your spirit identifies the mantle that they have, and you says, my office needs that administration. Did you hear what I said?
Yes, yes.
Because the mantle does not make the office work. The office is what actually empowers the mantle. But the Bible says this way. The Bible says that we all operate by the same spirit, but different administrations.
Mm-hmm.
Our President Barack Obama, what he does powerful isn't his administration,
right,
but because of the office that the administration holds. Does
yes.
that make sense?
Yes.
And so he throws this mantle on him, and the way this mantle is described to look, it's supposed to be like a hairy, kind of almost like a horse type skin, and it had like hair on it, and they said it was kind of battered because the mantle was used to be sheltered. Because sometimes the prophet had to sleep outside, and sometimes it had to block rain, and sometimes it had to block the sun and the heat. That these all the things that the mantle did. So the mantle not only did it protect him, but it protect him from the atmosphere. I think that sounds good.
Yes, amen, amen.
And so when he put this mantle on him, it is said that the way that this mantle looked had actually become a certain type of look that all the prophets had. And so when Elisha seen it, he recognized that was the type of mantle that was. And so he immediately knew what he had to do, okay? So how he responded to me is very interesting, because he immediately just ran and said, okay, let me go and find out about this man. In verse... I'm going to say in verse 20, He asked Elijah, he said, Elijah, well, let me go kiss my mother and my father. He said, let me go back. No, he said, go back again, for what have I done with you? Okay? So in other words, Elijah said, all right, you can go kiss your mother and your father goodbye. He said, but what do I have to do with you? Okay, I want to break this lie that your mentoree relationship is a friendly relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I want to break the lie that your mentor is your mother or your father. Your mentor is not your mother. Your mentor is not your father. Your mentor is not, I'm going to say your spiritual mother, your spiritual father. Your mentor, God puts them in your life to be your mentor, to be like your master.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way the relationship is ever going to reap what it's supposed to reap is if you understand servantship and not just sonship.
Yes.
Now, this man walks up to him. He throws this title on him. He gives him an office of the prophet. And then he says, okay, well, I'm going to go with you. Why? Because I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how to handle this mantle, so I'm going to follow you. And then the mentor says, well, I don't care what you do. What I got to do with you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I know people who left churches because they said their pastor didn't like them. And because the people didn't want to do, they didn't want to have anything to do with them. They weren't nice to them. They didn't speak well to them. Here, this mentor said, I don't care what you do. All I'm happy that I can get rid of the mantle. Because I understand how heavy this mantle is. Although it brought God glory, it has been very trying to my flesh. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is tired. It's wore out. So, you called to preach here. Yes, God said it's you. Here you go.
Mm-hmm.
What was interesting was Elisha was not offended by that because he understood when he met the mantle that this is what I was actually supposed to be doing my whole life. That I knew I wasn't supposed to be working with these oxen and working in this field. I knew that God had more for me. And the moment I realized it was the moment the mantle showed up in my life.
Mm, thank you, Lord.
He had no idea until the mantle showed up. Never thought about being a prophet. Never thought about the school of prophets. Never thought about doing ministry. Never did any of those things. But the moment the mantle showed up, he said, oh my goodness. Now I don't have to dread to go into the office every day because now I know why God wanted me alive. And this man put this mantle on me that I've never even heard of, but he gave me this mantle and I have to figure out how does this mantle work. So what I need is I need what he has because whatever he has, it has to work because he has the mantle.
Yes.
So he said, so the prophet, he said, so let me go say goodbye. He said, I don't care what you do, whatever you're going to do. So what he did, what I thought was very interesting. The Bible says that he went and he killed his oxen. He used the yoke that was on their neck to plow. He used that as fire. And then he fed everyone around him as a celebration for a going away party. And then he went to go follow the prophet. What I think was interesting was this. The reason why he killed the oxen and the reason why he destroyed the yoke is because he knew that he could not have a plan B because if he gave himself a plan B, he might find himself back on the field.
Yes.
So he burned his bridges so that he can't go back to it.
Right.
He literally said, okay, this I want to go here. And in order for me to go here, I have to stop myself from going in the past. I got to stop myself from reminiscing too hard. I got to delete the whole number out of my phone. I can't trust myself that I won't text. You know, I got to completely remove it. I got to really just burn the bridge so that way I have nothing to go back to. Because I believe that this is the thing that, and this is the whole reason why I'm alive. This is the reason why. And it doesn't matter to me how the mentor responds to me, because this thing is bigger than them. This thing is about the thing that called them to, and that if God can call them, God can call me, And so I have to figure out how to get the spirit and remove the position from the personality. What happens to us is we get so caught up in the personality that we never actually grab the position.
Right.
The position belongs to God.
Yes.
No matter how much we love our current president, I've used this as an example, as how much we love him, when he leaves that office of the presidency in that White House, there is still an office of a president.
Right.
We are called to the office of the prophetic, the apostolic, the evangelistic, the didactic, the evangelistic. We're called to all those offices, and the personality is not the office. And if you are going to ever utilize your mantle well, you're going to have to be able to separate the two. So he destroys his past life. He got rid of all those things. And then he goes following after Elijah. What I think was funny was when he started to go after Elijah, the first thing that Elijah did was Elijah tested him to see was he really prophetic the way God said he was. What I thought was interesting, Elijah did not really know if Elisha was prophetic. He didn't know if he qualified. He didn't know any of those things. He honestly didn't care. And so God was the one who knew all of these things. But, ready? God gave Elisha the appointment and gave him God confirmed him and God ordained him. His ordination never came from man.
Mm.
And technically, the man who God was trying to give him his mantle didn't even believe that he was supposed to hold on to the mantle. Because had he known that he was actually supposed to pull off in his whole spirit, he would have said, stay with me because I need to give you my spirit. But he didn't know it. He said, listen here, you're bothering me. I'm trying to finish up these few things that God told me to do. I've been in ministry for 5,900 years. And I know what I'm doing, son. I don't need you following me. You just stay here. You stay here with the sons. And I'm going to go to the next thing. You ready? First thing, notice that when the old prophet said to the young prophet, you stay here, don't follow me. You stay here and I'll be right back. He was testing him to see if he had a prophetic ear to really hear what was really being said behind the scenes. To see if he understood the difference between a command from God and a command from man. Okay, he had to test his hearing to see, can you hear God even if a voice tells you no? Can you hear God if he says yes?
Jesus.
Can you hear what God is really saying even when authority goes against what? Okay. Do you have the capacity or do you understand or are you able to recognize the frequency of the prophetic? Are your ears sensitive enough to hear that when God says it, that it doesn't matter if they say no, well, this is that way.
True.
When you really have the Holy Ghost and you have a prophetic ear, sometimes people can tell me a story, and while they're telling me the story, I hear the real track behind the story. And so they say, oh, ain't nothing wrong with me. I am messed up. I'm doing just fine. I am so depressed. My kids is doing good. I hate my kids. And I can hear the real track right behind it.
Right.
Why? Because God needs your ear not to be able to be influenced from a man's voice.
Yes,
you need
yes.
to hear his voice and a stranger you should not hear.
Yeah, amen.
Okay. So he says, okay, I'm going to go with you. He says, stay here. I'm about to leave. And he says, as long as the Lord liveth. And this is what I thought was very interesting. He says, as long as the Lord liveth, as long as you liveth, I'm going with you. In other words, what he was saying was, it's the Lord in you that I'm after. And as long as that is moving, as long as it's alive, and as long as you're alive, I know God is going to be on your life, so I have to follow you. So then, you ready? The old man was talking to the sons. He said, y'all, can y'all convince him to leave me alone? Y'all know me. Y'all been at the school. all y'all life. Y'all mamas dropped y'all off here, like Sammy's mama dropped him off at the temple. Y'all know, just tell him to stay here, stay here with y'all. Y'all can teach him, y'all can train him, and all this stuff. And so they said, hey, Elisha, you know your master is going to leave you. You know he planned on leaving you tonight. He said, oh, it's tonight. tonight is the night I'm leaving. He said, oh, okay. So he gets up and he goes. What I thought was interesting is that the sons never discerned that the master or that the father was leaving. Why? Because that was their spiritual father, and that was not their mentor. That was not their master. So they were ignorant, or they weren't as sensitive to the movings of the mantle and the way the mantle was working. So when the father was leaving, they said, oh, that's father. Of course, father is going to come back. But a servant said, no, this is something different. We can risk him leaving and no one gets what he has, because a servant doesn't receive an inheritance. So I have to be present when you leave in order for me to get what I need.
Okay.
So it happened several times. This happened three times. Bishop said it happened at least three times. And so finally, they get to the last stage. And when they get to this last stage, they get to the Jordan. And what was very interesting, when they get to this Jordan, it was actually a reenactment in the spirit realm, because this is the same Jordan that Moses and Joseph had to cross over, and when their mantles were exchanged. And so now it's the same Jordan that now it's time for the mantles to exchange. So they find themselves in the same exact place. And so in the spirit realm, this was a spiritual location of when mantles had to be transferred. Okay. Now, in this location, this place called there, in this spiritual location, there were two people there who were at totally opposites. They were both young, immature leaders who had never led before without a tutor. And there were two tutors who had mastered what God had told them to do, who was ready to retire, ready to expire, ready to let it go. One of the things interesting is that by the time you find your mentor, they should be exhausted, they should be tired, and they should have satisfied everything that God told them to do. If your mentor has not satisfied everything that God had told them to do, when you sit on their lap to learn or to glean, they then molest you because they have not been satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
That's what happens. That's what happens when you see I had a friend who, she said this lady was her spiritual mother. The lady was maybe 2 years older than her. This is my spiritual mother. How is that your spiritual mother? Ain't she trying to do the same stuff? You know, what has she done? And so what happens when opportunities showed up, when things showed up, the spiritual mother was taking a position, trying to take the spot. And what happened? She ended up being hurt from sitting on her lap and from pleading for her, because she used her to satisfy what she had not yet satisfied. Okay. So the old man gets to the point now. He said, okay, look, you done been with me enough. We done went to three schools. You heard me teach to all of the schools. You should get everything you wanted from me. You should have. He said, so why are you still following? What do you want? Ready? He said, well, I want double of your spirit. I want double anointing. Elijah said, all right, you ask a hard thing. But if you can see me leave, then you can have this mantle. Now, I first thought that him saying, I want double of your anointing, I said, well, maybe he was offended. And that's why he said it was a hard thing. But I don't really believe he was offended, because he didn't want But what he realized was that in order for you to have the mantle that's on my life, not only are you supposed to have the ability to hear at a certain frequency in the spirit, you also have to have the ability to see a certain way in the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that stops a lot of people from receiving the mantle of God on their life that actually is supposed to help them move is what I call perceptual deficiency. Their perception is so screwed and so wrong, and their perception is so messed up that they can never actually operate in the office. Why? Because they don't even understand what they're seeing. And so when they see miracles happen, they will call miracles demonic. They will call compassion enabling. They will call all the things that God actually uses to do miracles, they won't even see the miracles correctly. They will say, oh my God, Jesus, I cannot believe you just spit in that ground and now you're about to put it in his eyes. You. They're going to say, you mean to tell me we're going to feed 5,000 people with this boy's lunch? And then when they do it, and or you can be another scripture and say, I can't believe you took that boy's food. Ooh, that's so shady. Okay, they can even say, how are you a prophet of God, yet you are going against the king? What is the problem with you going against the king? Like, you should not be doing that. Like, what's the problem? You're supposed to listen to the king, abide by the rules of the king. You are a troublemaker.
Yep.
And so, even people who think this is the Old Testament doctrine. Even when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus and them in chapter 3 of the Gospel of St. John, he was talking to them in verse 3, he said that, in 3 and 3, and Jesus said, verily I say unto you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That you being born again, the first thing that was activating you being born again is your sight. You have to be able to see what it is that God is doing. You have to be able to see in the spirit realm. And the reason why you are offended with your mentor is because you are seeing incorrect.
Yes.
I remember when Bishop said these words to me, and I felt like I got punched in my whole gut. And I asked her about going somewhere, and she said, no, I don't think you should go. I said, all right. I listened to her, whatever she said, all right. And I started thinking to myself, I wonder why she don't want me to go. I asked the Lord, let me see the reason she doesn't want me to go. That was my prayer. I seen the reason, and it shocked me. So I said, Bishop, I know why you didn't want me to go to this place. And she said, yep, that's right. She said, you didn't see it at first because you wouldn't have accepted it if you wouldn't have seen it at first. She said, but you're right, you seem correct. Okay. She said these words to me. She said, you have to understand that what I will do with you is I will constrain you, but I will never restrain you.
Mm.
Okay.
Yes.
You have to see it correctly.
Right.
When, if you can see it, then you have right to that mantle. Ready? So then, Elijah had to say, look, I know on your watch, Jezebel was still alive. And you didn't get to get her. So, what's going on with Jehu and all of them? That's a lie. And you handled it all right, but I see the wear and tear that is done on you. So in order for me to be able to do this the way that I know I need to do this, I need to have double the anointing. Now, what I thought was interesting was that Elisha knew how double made things easier. Because when the prophet found him, he didn't find him with one ox. But the Bible says that he had two oxen and there was 12 on the whole field.
Hallelujah.
And so he understood that if you got two oxen, that it can move through fallow ground a little bit better. Okay. He realized that if he had truth, that he could go through some dirt that was the roughest of the dirt, and he can go through more territory at a short amount of time. And so he said, I mean, because when you met me, I was already an adult. I already was living a full life. And so this is a new thing that he added on me. And so I know that the presence of God is with me, but I don't need God's spirit. I need your spirit, because God gave you the thing that I need, okay? And so the Bible says that they cross over this water. He throws a mantle. The Bible says that the mantle is falling down, and Elisha sees a chariot of fire come and catch the prophet of God. I will go real far on a limb to say that the prophets of God in the spirit realm actually ride in the chariot. Okay. A flame chariot is what they ride in the spirit realm. And so for him to actually see that meant he had to actually ascend into the spirit realm. Okay. He actually had to ascend into the spirit realm, see the vehicle which the prophetic is, because the prophetic is actually the vehicle that brings the word of God from his mouth, from his mind, into reality, into the earth realm. And so that's the vehicle that he's actually seen that vehicle with his eyes in the spirit realm. And then he was able to catch the mantle. He put on that mantle, and then he was able to fulfill the things that God needed him to fulfill with the mantle. Every mantle comes with a specific assignment.
Yes.
One thing I think is very strange that when I was 8 years old, I preached my first message. My first message I preached when I was 8 years old, I preached it to our family church, and I preached how it was a shame that they made the women preach on the floor with that little ugly pulpit, and y'all made them wear only dresses and couldn't wear lipstick. And I preached it was a shame. I preached it so hard and so long till my dad literally had to pull me out of the pulpit, and I was in tears and everything. He had to pull me out. He said, okay, son, that's enough. The folks was mad at me, very, very, very angry with me. My mom ended up being the first woman ordained as a licensed minister in the state. They hated her for it. We would go into churches and they wanted her to preach. They would call her a missionary, and they would give her a little thing, and they would put her down on the floor, and they said, they used to say, she sure can teach, but they wouldn't say preach.
Yeah.
Because, okay, for my mother, my grandmother, when my grandfather decided to resign and things like that, my grandmother was supposed to take over our family church, but she couldn't do it, and she struggled with it because she was a woman. And here goes me. Young guy, I'm preaching around, you know, doing my little thing, thinking I'm really doing something. I was in the field. I was working my oxen, working what I thought was already given to me. And I was at a service, and I see this lady for the first time in my life, and I said, oh my God, who is she? I need that mantle. What's interesting is that I knew that I needed the mantle so much that I said, I'm going to go, and the skills that I have, I will consider them dumb. I won't even use it. I won't do nothing. I will come and sit down. I don't have to talk. I don't have to preach. I don't have to do nothing. I want to figure out how she get that thing to work like that. And then I met her in her spiritual office, and I met her in her natural office. And it never deterred me from what I was after. Folks called me sons and daughters. The same way the sons told this prophet, quit following. Quit following, let it go. Don't follow, let it go. You don't have to follow after him. They did the same thing to me. But what folks didn't realize is, yeah, y'all, you might be a son, you might was raised in it, on all those things, but something in me knows that this was the mantle that I need. And so I don't care. No, I'm not going nowhere. I have to see her make these transitions. very funny. I tell Bishop a lot, oh, you know I'm going with you. She said, oh, okay, well, come on. All right, here we go. Because it's important for me to see it. And I can see it. See, like, nobody could tell me how the Lord had to show me. He told me something. He said, I want you to realize that the mantle works both in the secular and in the sacred. The mantle does. And so you can't tell me it don't work because I seen her lay hands on people in front of a slot machine and they won. I seen it. So you can't never, I don't care what you tell me, you can't tell me I can't go nowhere and it don't work.
Right.
I seen it work.
Right.
Okay. Being in restaurants, people sitting all from on other part of the thing, ain't said nothing to us, don't know who we are, nothing, and said, well, we just want to pay for the meal. It's just something about, I seen it. And so, because I seen it, now I understand what this mantle does. So when you see me walk through, I'm going to walk through with the same, doing the same things that the mantle does. My friends laugh at me. I jokingly call her little Jesus, and my friends start calling me that, not knowing I call her that. I've seen God do absolutely amazing things. I was at an Indian restaurant. I see a young guy, and I said, oh, Lord, he's so depressed. So my friend Lisa says, I wish God gives me an opportunity to talk to him. So the young guy, he looked over and he said, have you guys ordered yet? I was like, yes, this is what I'm talking about. I was like, no. I said, what are you going to order? So I walked up to him. Now, this is, now, imagine how weird this is. So this strange black kid that you don't know, and you're a young Jewish young man. I grabbed his hand. And I said, you know, God's going to make sure things work for you. He said, what do you mean? And I said, I see the situation that you're in. He said, what situation? I said, are you going to be evicted soon? He said, can I sit down? I said, sure you can. So I'm holding his hand. And I said, but this is the reason why this is happening. That's because God has called you from a child. I said, what you don't realize is that it's illegal for you to have anything unless it comes by faith if you're the just of God. The Bible says we live, the just shall live by faith. He means it. And so if it didn't take faith in order for you to acquire it, it's illegally there, and trust me, you'll lose it. Trust me. You'll lose it. Why? Because it showed up without faith being on it. Faith is the substance, the DNA, the characteristic of God. And so when God is looking at the world and he says, oh, it's good, that's good, that's good, that's good, that's good. Why? Because he's seen the DNA characteristic of faith in it. And so he knew that it had an eligible right to be there. So that's why he didn't destroy it. Okay. This is the reason why he didn't destroy it. And so when it shows up because of faith, the God said, oh, yeah, it has a legal right to be here. And so if it showed up by faith, then that means God is required to keep it there. Because the only reason why it came there is because of faith. See, that's why when the big housing market went down and everybody selling their house and everything, because a whole bunch of people used them subprime loans and they were blaming it on God, saying they got it by faith, but they didn't. They got it by credit. The Bible says he will give you a house that you did not build. Do you know that God can literally give you a house?
Yes.
Paid for? That you don't have to sign no papers for it? That somebody can sign a deed over to you? And and if you can have that level of faith, it can show up that way. And so then if it shows up that way, then God is then required to maintain it. But when you do it on your own, then you have to maintain it yourself.
Yes.
Mm.
So I said this to this young guy. So he's like, wow. He said, well, what does God want me to do? I said, you're a painter. I said, I see you painting. And as you paint, I'm just prophesying to his voice. Now he's crying. He says, I thank God for you. He said, and I never eat Indian food. I said, me either.